My name is Stanislaw Robert Liberto with AV Ultra. Today we're going to be making something that looks a little like this. And what we're going to be covering today are 3D layers in Apple Motion, lights, and simple camera movement behaviors. So let's go ahead and get started. When you first open up your AV Ultra Motion Lesson 9 Start, you'll be presented with a background. And what we're going to do is just create our text layer. Once we've created our text layer, what we want to do is we want to move our text layer out of our background group into a new group. And while we're at it, let's go ahead and close our background and lock it. Let's have a quick conversation about 3D layers as opposed to 2D layers. In 2D layers, they work exactly like you imagine they work in any other compositing program. We have one layer that is sitting on top of another layer. If I move this whole group and I use my command bracket left, you can see I put it behind that other group. Right now, we can't really see it because of its blend mode. I'm gonna put that back. There's a couple special things that 3D layers can do that 2D layers can't do. Let's go ahead and rename this group Area 1. And we're going to go ahead and shut that off. And we're going to create just a couple circle shapes. I'm going to hold on to Shift Alt Option to make a perfect circle. And we're going to just color this circle a little bit. And I'm going to duplicate that circle. And we're going to make this one a little bit lighter. And we're going to go into its properties. And we're going to scale it down. And one last one. Now in our group here, we're gonna also name this Area 2. We're gonna call this Top, Mid, and Bottom. So now we have our Area 1 and our Area 2. You'll notice that my Area 2 is obviously sitting on top of my AV Ultra tutorials. So let's talk about 3D layer space. If I go to my specific layer stacks here, you'll notice that I have this little icon. And this little icon will actually change them between a 2D or 3D layer. Let's go ahead and click on both of these. And you can see that this has changed our icons. In our group settings, that's also changed our type from 3D to 2D. So effectively, that's what hitting this button is doing. Now that we have these in a 3D space, let's go to our position. And now in our position, we have an X, Y, and a Z. So if I wanted to, I can kind of push this further back in space. It doesn't look like it's doing very much other than just scaling and moving behind our text layer. Let's add a couple things to our scene to make things a little bit more easier to work with. If we go to our add objects and we add a light, we'll have something interesting happen. You'll notice that right away, everything gets shaded. And the reason for that is because our light can only affect 3D layers. So if I turn off this layer, you can see our background isn't affected by this light because it's a two-dimensional object. But our text is absolutely affected by this light. And so is our Area 2. If we take this light and we select it, you'll notice that we have an X and Y. And this little blue arrow is pointing straight at us. That is our Z. If I move this to the left or to the right, you can see it works exactly like you imagine a light bulb to work. In fact, this is a point light, and we'll be talking about lights further in another lesson. So I'm going to go ahead and turn that off for right now. One other thing that we can do with 3D layers is add a camera. A camera will let us move through this virtual three-dimensional space. If I selected my camera, you'll notice a few things pop up on my screen. I have this new window here that says active camera, and I have this control over here. It gives me a pan, an orbit, and a dolly. And if I click any one of these, I'm actually moving around this three-dimensional space, and we can see a little bit more clearly what's happening here. So if I pull to the side, you can see here is my Area 1 and here is my Area 2. So let's go ahead and take this Area 2. Because I want to be animating this camera a little bit later, I'm going to undo that and just go back flat. What I want to do is I want to change my perspective here. So I want to get out of my active camera. So if I go to front, back, left, right, top, and bottom, you can see that we're viewing our canvas in a different way. What I tend to do is I like to go into perspective and move around that way. Here you can clearly see our camera and what it's focusing on and our different layers. So if I'm moving around here, I'm not affecting the camera right now. I'm just moving around the space so I can see what the camera is going to be looking at. And if I turn my light back on, we can see a little bit more clearly where that light is shining. So if I take this light and I move this behind my text, you'll notice that even though my text was white, the light source is now technically behind it, Let's go ahead and build this a little bit further. So I'm going to turn off my lights right now just so we're not distracted by everything else that's happening with our darkness and our light and mixing those things together. And we're going to go to our area 2, and I'm going to go ahead and change the properties of this group, and I'm going to rotate this negative 90 degrees. And so now what we've done is we've created this kind of plate for everything to sit on. And I want to work this a little bit further, so I'm going to turn off my area 1. And we really just want to focus on this area here. So if I open up my area 2, we've got our bottom, our top, and our middle. And I'm going to take my middle, and I'm just going to move this up in the Z coordinates, just about 10 pixels. And I'm going to do the same thing with the top, except I'm going to move this up 20 pixels. So if I use my camera controls here and I kind of zoom in, what we can see is we've stacked these different layers one on top of the other. Now I want to add a drop zone to this area. So I'm going to go to my area 2. I'm going to go to add object and drop zone. And right now it's just placed it flat along with everything else again in its X, Y, and Z coordinates. So I'm going to scale this down. And I'm going to use our 3D gizmo, which is down here. And you'll notice that now that we have things in 3D space, we've got this X, Y, and Z, as well as these three dots. And these three dots let us rotate our object in three-dimensional space. And when we're working with 3D objects like this, you'll notice in this bottom right corner here, our active camera. And that's what our camera is seeing right now. It could be a little hard to rotate these items and get them exactly the way you want. So if I hold on to shift as I start rotating them, it locks them to 45 degree angles. I was just a little beyond 0 degrees, so I'm just gonna change that to 90. And I'm gonna use this gizmo here to move this up, and we're gonna scale it down just a little bit further. You'll notice in my scene, it looks like I'm hanging off the edge here, but when I'm working with my active camera view, it doesn't necessarily look like that. How can I tell what exactly is true and what exactly is happening? Because we're looking at 3D layer spaces in a two-dimensional scene on this canvas, it can be really hard to tell as far as perspectives. If we go to our top right corner, we have our different views. And if I select this view, you'll notice now that I have my perspective view and I have my right, I can change this to a perspective as well. And I can kind of rearrange this so I can see exactly how I want to position my items. And it makes things a little bit easier when I'm working with them to be able to tell exactly where my items are in space. I'm gonna turn that light back on just to take a look at the scene. I can see what's happening. That's good right now. I like a little bit of the shading. In fact, I'm gonna go ahead and add something to my drop zone right away. And so I've added just a little video to my drop zone, and I'm gonna change my view back to one view, and we're gonna reset our view to fit. There's one more group that I want to add to this, and that is going to be our floor. So I'm going to go to my generators, my image generators, and we're going to go to gradient. And by default, it gives us this blue gradient, and that's not necessarily what I want. So now we've got a floor for different layers, and I'm going to drop it down just a wee bit so it's underneath all my different areas. So we've got our background, we've got our floor, we've got our area 1 and our area 2. So let's start moving this in 3D space and giving it that reflection and that camera movement. If you remember from my very first Apple Motion tutorial, if we went down to our 3D layer, turned on our reflection, it created this really nice instant reflection for whatever is above it in its own space. I can open up my reflection tab. We can blur that out a little bit and even add a bit of a fall off. So that creates a really nice, soft, blended reflection. And I'm gonna work with that reflection a little bit more and actually apply that to my different circles. So if I go to my bottom, I'm gonna turn on the reflection. You can see that's very harsh. We're gonna just turn up that blur, and same with this reflection. Blur it out just a little bit less. And then our top and really blur that as well. So let's turn off our area 2 and turn on our area 1. And you can see there's our text, and you'll notice that it's being cut off by our floor. And that's not necessarily what I want. So I'm going to take my area 1, move things in X and Y, Z space, and just move that. And you'll notice that my camera is now being cut off because my floor is right there. And that's okay, because I'm going to take my camera and move my active camera, and we are going to pan this. And right away, we've got some really nice reflection going on. Our background is really nice and soft. Let's go ahead and start moving these in 3D space. So if I turn on my area 2, you'll notice that it's sitting right there. It's a little hard to see what's happening, so I'm going to turn on my two views. And I'm going to change this to a top view. And this is gonna let me see everything. So here's my area one and here's my area two. I'm gonna take my area two, turn on my 3D gizmo, and we're just gonna push this back in space. And now we can see that that is scooting further back. In fact, I'm gonna put it all the way over here. We're gonna rotate the whole group. So our first text layer is right here, and our second one is right here. So I'm gonna go back to my area one, and I wanna turn on that light. And you'll notice that when I turn on that light, everything else goes dark. And the reason for that is because as soon as you have a single light source in your scene, it's going to use that as its light, as opposed to the ambient light that you would normally have. If you didn't have a light in your scene, it's just showing you what everything looks like. But as soon as you add a light, everything else can go a bit darker. Just like before, I'm gonna move this guy up and I'm gonna move him a little closer to me. So we get a nice little shading. What's great is you can see the reflection of that light right there. I'm gonna duplicate that light and I'm actually going to set it up over here. And we're gonna move the secondary light to our area two. I wanna be able to jump to our area two and see exactly what that looks like. So what I can do is once I have things in a 3D layer space, you'll notice that I have this little icon and this lets me focus just on that area or that specific layer to work with it. So if I click this, it is now showing me area two and only area two. I'm gonna move that light copy into area two just so I can work with it. And I'm gonna scoot this down just see what this looks like. So maybe I want this lit from the top a little bit more and a little bit pulled back. All right, and change it to a single screen. Now that we've got our layer set up and we've got our 3D space set up, let's actually work with this camera. I'm gonna go ahead and close everything else just so that way they're just gonna work with my camera layer here. In my camera layer, you'll notice that if I go under my properties, I have my position X, Y, and Z, my rotation X, Y, and Z. If I move my camera using my tools, that's effectively changing my transformations in my inspector. So if I wanted to, I can actually set a keyframe and move forward and kind of hunt down that other layer. And now if I play that back, it's already not exactly what I was looking for. So if I move this back here and we kind of twirl this around, I've got to push and pull these keyframes quite a bit to get them to do what I want them to do. And there's nothing wrong with using keyframes. However, it can get a little tedious, especially when you're working in a 3D space. So luckily for us, we have some camera behaviors. So if I go to my library and I go to my behaviors and I go to my camera, you'll notice that I have Dolly, focus, framing, sweep, zoom in and out, and zoom a layer. For our purposes today, we're just gonna be looking at the framing and the Dolly, as well as a sweep. And I'm gonna drag this Dolly onto my camera. And you'll notice that it is taking up the entire length of my composition, and that's fine. Actually, I want that. I usually put on a little Dolly like this for a lot of my videos. And if I go under my behavior inspector, you'll notice that I have a distance and I have a speed. If I pull this back, my Dolly here, as I play this back, it is going to be moving approximately 1,064 pixels by the time it reaches the end of the composition. I don't want that far, so I'm gonna just pull this in just a bit. And instead of constant, I like to use ease both. And the reason for that is because it gives it that weight that it slowly kind of moves out, speeds up a little bit, and then it slows back down. The second behavior that we're going to add is our framing. And this is probably one of my favorite behaviors because it's instant gratification. So I'm gonna drag my framing into my camera. And I don't want to take up the whole composition. I just want it to go to about 60 frames. And I don't want it to start right away. I want it to start at frame 30. And if I play this back, nothing is happening. And that's fine because we have to actually work with our behavior. So if I click on my framing and I go to my inspector, it's asking for a target. And I'm going to drag my area two into this framing behavior. So if I click and I drag this and I drop that on there, now if I play this back, you'll see that it's moving from one right to the other. But it's not working exactly the way I want. It's still framing it. It's framing it actually perfectly. You can see that it's hitting the very top and the very bottom of area two. It's looking at it from the Z positive axis. And that's not what I want. So if I come to my target face in my behavior, you'll notice that I can specify different places for it to look. So in our purposes right here, we're gonna be looking at the bottom Y. That's still framing up, that's looking great. However, it's not exactly where I want it to be. I want to fine tune this a little bit. And that's what we have our framing offset for. So if I take my framing offset, I can twirl this down and I can actually work with this in the X and the Y to get this a little bit more closer to what I'm looking for. And maybe I want this a bit closer. And now if I play this back, we can see it is moving from my first area straight to my second area. We have a few other things that we want to do to kind of clean things up. Maybe I want this dolly to end right around here. So that's going to be creating that movement throughout. But also you'll notice that we have this hard line back here. If I go under my camera properties, you'll notice that we have our near fade and our far fade. So I can always hit my far plane here and drag this back and work with this just to soften out that background. So I've adjusted this far plane, pulled that back, and I'm working the same way with this near fade and this far fade. If I pull too far back with my far fade, everything is faded out, and that's not necessarily what I want. I just want to create this nice gradation back here. The last behavior that we're going to look at here is our sweep. And our sweep behavior creates this nice movement from point A to point B, much like our framing, but in a different manner. So if I come back to my library, we're gonna go ahead and put our sweep on here, and you'll notice that it says rotates a camera around an axis. I'm gonna place that sweep right here, and we don't want that taking up the whole thing, so I can just select it and hit O, and that will trim it out. And I don't want it to start until the camera starts moving, so we'll hit I. And now you'll notice that it's kind of moving across there. Again, not exactly what I want, so I'm gonna go to my inspector, and you'll see that it starts at 0 degrees, ends at 30, and we can set our speed, so I'm gonna ease both. And instead of swiveling on the Y axis, I wanna actually tilt this on the X. And instead of 30 degrees, we want maybe negative 15. And now you can see I might have to go back to my framing and adjust that a little bit more. But now we've created a very complex camera movement in three-dimensional space with reflections and some lights. If you're looking for more information about lights and cameras, feel free to leave me a comment. I want to do a lot more with lights and cameras because I feel like that's really powerful in Apple Motion. In our next lesson, we're going to be taking a look at exports and getting things out of Apple Motion. So things with transparencies for lower thirds, things that you want to edit very quickly, or things for the web. So we're just gonna be taking a quick look at how to export things properly and maybe how to speed up some renders. Again, my name is Stanislaw Robert Liberta with AV Ultra. Thanks a lot for watching. And as always, I hope you found this information useful.